Unit 4 we have done with the adjustments also, isn't it? So we have left over with few adjustments, which I'll just forward you the notes. I just wanted, it's important to just cover the ratio analysis, which constitutes 70% of Unit 5. So I thought to just cover this one, Unit 5. So if possible, after the mid or the last day of the mid, we may take a physical one class for revision of 4th and 5th unit. Okay, on the last day of your mid-exam, or we'll plan in such a way. Okay, is it fine? Shall we take like that? As of, I'll just take 5th unit. And for just revision of 4th and 5th unit, we'll take offline, that is the last day of your exam. When is your last exam?
24th,
I guess.
24th
falls on ma'am. 24th
is the last exam, ma'am.
24th
morning.
24th, Epud, Nana, the day falls on which day?
Saturday.
So coming Saturday would be the last. So we'll plan on that day to have a class of revision of 4th and 5th unit. Like I'll tell you all the adjustments with one problem, and we'll do all the ratios with the this one on the last day. Okay, so those who are interested can come. It's not compulsion, because offline anedi, I need to even take the permission. I'll just confirm again. So let's start with Unit 5. Nana, are you comfortable with Unit 4? Like we didn't give any tough problems. We have given, like the other faculty didn't cover the adjustments also. So the paper is very simple. Don't get panic. Prepare the theory as well as the final accounts, the journal entries, and in the case of Unit 3, prepare all the unit-wise questions what we have given. So at the end of this class, we'll just discuss what you need to write for what question and all. Okay, so let's start with our Unit 5. So as I said, Unit 5, I didn't share the screen. As I said, Unit 5 is the analysis of the statements what we have prepared in Unit 4. Okay, Unit 4, what we have done, the whole process of maintenance of final accounts, isn't it? Right, how we prepare the final accounts right from the scratch, that is journal entries. First is the process of journal entry, isn't it? Then journal entry, tarvata, the next one is, what is the next process? After journal entry?
Ledger account.
Then after ledger,
trial balance, and next balance.
Yeah. So what is the base for trial balance? Ledger accounts are the base for trial balance. Okay. So trial balance, tarvata, the last step is from the trial balance, we prepare the final accounts. And what do you mean by final accounts? We prepare three important statements. What are those?
Trading account, profit and loss account, and balance sheet.
Balance sheet. Trading account reveals gross profit. Profit and loss account reveals net profit. And balance sheet reveals assets and liabilities. And just take down one of the another important concept, Nana. Accounting equation. Just write down. It's not there in the PPT or the PDF. Just write down in Unit 4 only. This is also one of the theory question that I have missed. Accounting equation is equal to. Accounting equation is equal to assets is equal to liabilities plus capital. Accounting equation. What do you mean by accounting equation is what one of the theory small question. So accounting equation is equal to assets is equal to liabilities plus capital. So this is nothing but what do you mean by accounting equation? So the total balance sheet, how does it projects? It projects the capital, isn't it? The capital, you add net profit. If you have drawings, you deduct and put the net capital outside the column, isn't it? So that is plus and liabilities. What do you mean by liabilities? The other liabilities such as creditors, bills payable, bank overdraft, any provisions you have. So these all constitute liabilities. So assets refer to what are the two types of assets we have in the balance sheet?
Current assets and...
Very good. Current assets plus fixed assets. So here, this is what one of the short theory question that we have. What do you mean by accounting equation? Accounting equation is nothing but assets is equal to liabilities plus capital, where assets is equal to fixed assets plus current assets. Liabilities refer to current liabilities such as bills payable or bank overdraft, creditors, and long-term loans and so on. Plus capital. What do you mean by capital? Capital refer to capital plus net profit minus drawings. So this is known as accounting equation, which is one of the important question that we have in unit 4. This is a theory question. Okay. So that's it with unit 4.
Some are trying to join it.
Okay, so now let's start with unit 5. So listen carefully, Nana. Unit 5 is nothing but analysis. They give us the ready-made information. They give us the ready-made information. We prepare ratios from it. We have different techniques to analyze the financial statements, out of which ratio analysis is one technique. Like this, we have different budgeting. We have different techniques of evaluating the performance of the financial statements, out of which you have only ratio analysis. So what do you mean by ratio analysis? Ratio analysis, nothing but the quantitative expression. It's nothing but the quantitative relationship between two variables, which are comparable. So here, who are the interested parties who analyze the financial statements? Who does the analysis of the financial statements of a company?
Accountants and management.
Accountants and management is one because it's their own company. We have the other interested parties. Who are those? The investors.
Shareholders.
Yeah, investors. Investors include shareholders, debentures, and loans, isn't it? So these are all the people who are really interested in what is the financial position? Is it safe for us to invest here? Is it safe for us to give loans to this company? Is it safe to buy securities from this company? So the investors are the first party who are interested in the financial analysis of the company. The second one is the competitors. The third one is, what is the third one we have? Government. Why is government interested? Why is government interested in the financial statements of a company?
Taxes.
Very good. Very good. Taxes. Taxes is what they are interested in, because if they get a doubt, why does this is only the amount of tax that have been paid, they analyze the financial statements. These are nothing but reporting. Reporting is compulsory as per accounting standards to furnish all the financial statements. So based on this financial statement, the analysis is done by all the interested parties as well as the company also. So the investors, the competitors, the government, the general public are the people who analysis of the financial statements. So in this unit, what you have is they give you the ready-made information of profit and loss account or the balance sheet and ask you to prepare ratios. We have simple formulas to calculate the ratios. So you got a background. What is this? Okay. What is this unit about? All of you? Did you get an idea as why we are doing this? Yes, Nana?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so now let's start with the ratio analysis are classified into 4 categories of ratios, Nana. It's a little bit clumsy on the screen, but can you identify a concept of ratio analysis with simple problems is what we have. So these are classified into 4. The first one is liquidity ratio. The second one is activity ratio. The third one is profitability ratios. The last one is proprietary/solvency/financial/leverage/capital structure. There are 5 names for 4th set of ratios. Okay. liquidity ratios, activity ratio, turnover ratio, or performance ratio. Just take down, Anna, quickly. Take down the heading ratio analysis, broadly classified into four categories. First one, liquidity ratio. First one, liquidity ratios. You have two in this. Just put two. Two ratios are there in liquidity ratios. Then activity ratio. Activity ratio / turnover ratio / performance ratio. So this you will be asked in MCQs. What is the other name for activity ratio or and all? But as of you don't have unit 5, but still. Okay, activity ratio / turnover ratio / performance ratios. Next, third one, profitability ratio. Third one, profitability ratio. Fourth one, here spelling is wrong. Proprietary, P-R-O-P-R-I-E-T-A-R-Y. Proprietary ratios. Proprietary / capital structure / solvency / leverage ratios. So these are the four set of ratios that we have in unit 5 with short formulas and problems. Is it clear, Nana? Shall we start with the first set of ratio, liquidity ratio? So these are the four set of ratios. Liquidity ratio have two ratios. So why is this ratio prepared is, this ratio helps the investors and the other parties to identify what is the current financial position of the company to meet its short-term commitments. Okay, to meet its short-term commitments. So what are the items that we take from the balance sheet to calculate current ratio and quick ratio? This liquidity ante enta easyga it can convert its assets into cash. So that is known as liquidity. So how much is the liquidity ratio, which are classified into two, current ratio and quick ratio? And why is this calculated? This ratio is calculated to identify the ability of a company to meet its short-term commitments. Okay, to meet its short, how efficient is the company to meet its short-term commitments? And this current ratio is the first ratio. Current ratio is the ratio between the current assets and the current liabilities. Now write down the formula for current ratio. Current ratio is equal to current assets divided by current liabilities. The formula for current ratio is equal to current assets divided by current liabilities. Okay, where current assets is equal to stock, cash in hand, cash at bank, stock, cash in hand, cash at, are you writing then all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Stock, cash in hand, cash at bank, prepaid expenses, bills receivable, B by R, Raskundi abbreviation. Bills receivable. Then short term investments. Short-term investments, income yet to be received or accrued income, debtors, debtors, debtors. So these all constitute current assets. So he will give you the balance sheet. You have to pick all these items from the balance sheet and calculate the total assets, current assets. You know the distinction between the current assets and fixed assets. What do you mean by distinction between current assets and fixed assets?
Current assets change over a period of time. Fixed assets remains
It is for the lifetime of the business, isn't it? We don't frequently purchase the current assets. So we take only, we don't frequently purchase the fixed assets. We take only current assets to calculate current ratio. Current assets are the assets which can be quickly converted into cash with zero risk, are known as current assets. Stock refer to the finished stock that we have, which is easy to convert into cash. Cash at hand is ready-made cash. Cash at bank is what the cash you have at bank. Prepaid expenses are nothing. What do you mean by prepaid expenses? We have done this adjustment, isn't it? So what do you mean by prepaid expenses? Anyone, Nana? What do you mean by prepaid expenses? We have this adjustment, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. Reverse of outstanding expenses.
Very good. Reverse of outstanding expenses. Prepaid expenses are nothing but expenses paid in advance. So this is also a current asset. Bills receivable, we have issued bill, they didn't pay us. Short-term investments within a period of 3 months to 1 year, we consider as current asset. Long-term investment is not considered as current asset. Income yet to be received refer to accrued income. Okay, accrued income or income yet to be received. We have to receive but didn't receive. If you remember, we have done this problem where we were having 5,000 accrued income. Isn't it? So this is the concept of current asset, debtors. So debtors is also a current asset. So we add all to arrive at current assets. Now coming to the current liabilities, outstanding expenses, bills payable, creditors, all provisions, income received in advance constitutes current liabilities, bank overdraft also. So these are all known as current liabilities. So what we need to do is we have to pick this from the balance sheet. A balance sheet would be provided and you would be asked to calculate liquidity ratio, or if you directly ask, calculate current ratio. Write down the formula: current ratio is equal to current assets by current liabilities, and then start calculating current assets by picking all the items that constitute current assets. Then start calculating current liabilities by picking up which constitutes the current liabilities. Then divide current assets by current liabilities. And you have to write the interpretation for each ratio. What do you mean by interpretation? Interpretation is nothing but what is your suggestion regarding the ratio? How is the financial position? And as per the accounting standards, the rule of thumb, the current ratio should be 1:1. Okay, the standard for current ratio is, 2:1.
Excuse me, ma'am.
No.
Ma'am, one person is waiting, ma'am. Can you allow her?
Okay, as per the accounting standards, rule of thumb, the rule for this standard is 2:1. So you have to comment on the standard as to what is the ratio and is it meeting with the standard or not. If it is more than 2 and it is more than 1, then you have to comment based on that. The actual standard is for every 2 rupee of current asset, they should be 1 rupee of current liability. For every 2 rupee of current asset, there should be 1 rupee of current liability. Is that clear? This is the standard for this ratio now. Is this clear? This is the first ratio in liquidity ratios. Now quickly take down a problem. Calculate current ratio using the following information. Stock 2,50,000. Debtors, stock 2,50,000. Debtors 1,25,000. Cash at bank 2,50,000. Cash in hand నాది నువ్వు క్లియర్ గా చెప్పావు కదా ఏది అనేది. So did you take Nana? Did you take the problem? Stock 2,50,000, debtors 1,25,000, cash at bank 2,50,000, cash in hand 1,25,000, prepaid expenses 50,000, bank overdraft 50,000, short term investments 1,25,000. Creditors 2,00,000. Outstanding expenses 50,000. Okay, so I have directly pick up from the balance sheet, but you need to pick up whatever they have given, or sometimes they will give you the current assets and current liabilities. You have to add up all. Is this clear, Nana? Now pick up all the current assets. What constitutes current assets? Stock, debtors, cash at bank, cash in hand, prepaid expenses. So these are the things that, and short term investments. What do you mean by short term investments? If it is less than 1 year, we take it as current asset. If he takes investments and doesn't mention anything, we don't take it as a current asset. Is it clear, Nana?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So how much did you get the current assets? The total of current assets is? What is the current assets total? Nana, have calculators quickly do. We have to do all the four ratios. It's 10:30. We have started just one. What is the answer for current assets?
9,25,000.
Then calculate the current liabilities. What constitutes current liabilities here? Bank overdraft, outstanding expenses. Are there anything else? Do we have any other liabilities, current liabilities? Nana, are you following?
Nothing.
Yeah, nothing. Only we have two items, bank overdraft and outstanding expenses. So 1,00,000. So what would be the ratio? Current ratio is equal to current assets by current liabilities. Okay. So how much are the... Achha, 2,00,000 ain't it, Nana?
Creditors.
Oh, we have creditors also. Yeah, yeah. So you have to even take creditors. I forgot creditors. Where did she write the creditors? Here she didn't take in the problem. But yeah, 2,00,000 is what? So the total of the current liabilities is 3,00,000. Okay. So what is current ratio? Current ratio is equal to current assets divided by current liabilities. So current assets are 9,25,000. And current liabilities are 3,00,000. So how much do you get ratio? 3.08:1, isn't it? What is the standard? Standard for this ratio is 2:1. So is the financial position good or bad? How do you comment? Actually, there should be 2 rupees assets for 1 rupee current liability, but it is more than 2 rupees. So, is it good or is it bad?
Good.
Very good, isn't it? It is very good financial position, or the financial position is good, as it is enough to have 2 rupees current asset with the 1 rupee of current liability, is what we can say in terms of rupees. was actually the standard is 2:1. That refers to for every 2 rupee, the 1 rupee is enough. But here it is 3.08:1. So the what you need to write is the current ratio is 3.08:1 and the financial position of the firm is very good as the standard is 2:1. Is it clear, Nana? So this is how you have to calculate current ratio. Quickly pick up all the current assets. By the time you have done the fourth unit, you can identify the items, isn't it? So what is the nature of item? Does it come under current asset or does it come under fixed asset? And if it is asset or if it is a liability. Liability, are the liabilities current capital rather than except capital and long-term loans, we take all as the current liability. Okay? Is that clear? Bills payable, creditors, bank overdraft. These all constitutes, creditors constitutes current assets. And the standard is 2:1. Shall we move on to the second ratio, quick ratio? This is the second ratio in liquidity ratios. We are in first set of ratios, liquidity ratios. Liquidity ratio have two. One is current ratio. The second one is quick ratio. Quick ratio is also known as acid test ratio. Is it clear, Nana? Quick ratio is also known as acid test ratio. Now, what is the formula for quick assets? The formula for quick ratio is equal to quick assets by current liabilities. And quick assets refer to current assets, what we have calculated above, minus stock plus prepaid expenses. We remove from current assets stock and prepaid expenses to arrive at quick assets. Quick ratio is more quicker than current ratio. It is more risk-free to convert assets into cash. So this is known as quick ratio or acid test ratio. And quickly we can find out the liquidity position of the firm with 0% or 100% accuracy. So this is known as quick ratio. Therefore, we are removing stock and we are removing prepaid expenses. What do you mean by stock? Because stock takes time to convert into cash. What do you mean by stock? It's nothing but the final goods that you have in your godown. It takes time for you to convert that into cash. And prepaid expenses are nothing but expenses paid in advance, which comes in the next year. So therefore, we are removing stock and prepaid expenses to arrive pure quick assets. Is it clear, Nana? And the liabilities are same. Current liability are same as how we have calculated for current ratio. The formula for quick ratio is equal to quick assets divided by current liabilities. Now, what are the quick assets we have to calculate? Current assets we have done at 9,25,000. Stock is 2,50,000 and prepaid expenses are 50,000. And here we got quick assets are 6,25,000 and current liabilities are same as how we have calculated in the above current ratio. And the ratio is 2.01:1. Is this right, Nana? Just check. 6,25,000 divided by 3 lakhs.
Ma'am,
2.08.
Yeah, 2.08:1 is quick ratio. And the standard for this ratio is 1:1. Okay. What is the standard for current ratio?
2:1.
For every 2 rupee, there should be 1 rupee. And quick assets ki 1:1. It has reduced. For every 1 rupee, there should be 1 rupee of current liability. And here is the financial position good for this particular situation?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes.
Isn't it? If it was reverse 1:2:2.08, then how come is the position?
Bad.
Not satisfactory. No. They can't...
They have more of obligations rather than assets. So that's not a good sign of financial position. This is the end of current ratio, Nana. We have two types. One is current ratio and quick ratio. Now, just to tell a problem, quickly calculate this. We will move on to the next problem. Okay. Calculate current ratio and quick ratio from the given information. Calculate current ratio and quick ratio from the given information. Shall I start, Nana? Shall I start with the items?
Yes, ma'am.
Closing,
yes, ma'am.
Closing stock 25,000. Sundry debtors 12,500. Wages prepaid 2,500. Sundry creditors 8,000. Rent outstanding 2,000. Now calculate quick ratio and current ratio.
Ma'am, could you repeat once again?
Stock, closing stock 25,000, sundry debtors 12,500, wages prepaid 2,500, sundry creditors 8,000, rent outstanding 2,000. How much is the quick current ratio, Nana? Nana, did you get the current ratio? How much is the current ratio? Are you there, all of you? What is the total of current assets? What is the total of current assets? Did you get 40,000? Yeah, why are you not responding, Nana? Are you sleeping? Feeling sleepy, all of you?
No, madam.
Current liability 10,000.
Yes, ma'am, 10,000.
What is the ratio?
4:1, ma'am.
4:1. And how is the financial position now?
Very good.
Yeah, very good. For 4:1, and for every 4 rupees, there is 1 rupee of current assets. So we can say that the financial position of the firm is very good. Now calculate quick ratio. Quick ratio is equal to quick assets by current liabilities, where quick assets is equal to current assets minus stock plus prepaid expenses. So how much do you get?
12,500
divided by 10,000. How much do you get? 1.25:1. How is the quick ratio position?
Satisfactory.
Yeah, it's good. Like, so this is how you need to write interpretation. The financial position of the firm is good as the standard is 2:1 and the firm has 4:1. And for the quick ratio, the standard is 1:1 and here it is 1.25:1. It is satisfactory. This is the end of the first set of ratios, Nana. Are you clear? Are you done with? Did you understand? Pick all the items. What constitutes current assets? Pick all items which constitute current liabilities. Add all current assets and current liabilities. Calculate the ratio and compare it with the standard. Then current assets and quick assets distinction is you have to deduct stock plus prepaid expenses to arrive at quick assets. This is how we calculate the quick ratio. And current liabilities are same as how in the current ratio. Is this clear, Nana? End of the first set of problems. Shall we move on to activity ratios?
Okay.
Nana, Ardhamayinda Andarki, did you follow? Yes, Akash. Sahul.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Sreecharan and all are there in the room?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So, did you follow, Nana, all of you? This is all simple. The thing is, you just identify the current assets and current liabilities and then pick up from the balance sheet. He'll give you the balance sheet and you need to pick up and compare it with the standard. Now, going to the second set of ratios, activity ratios. So, activity ratios are also known as turnover or it is also known as performance ratios. And these ratios are calculated to find out the efficiency and capability of the firm to convert its stock into cash and to convert its debtors into cash and to convert its creditors to pay off. Okay, so this is known as activity ratio or turnover. Turnover and conversion. Conversion of stock into cash. And how many times is the company turning its stock into cash? The higher, the better and the most capable company is what we can see. Debtors, how efficient is the company to convert and collect all its debts into cash? And creditors, how efficient is the company to pay off its creditors? What do you mean by debtors? Other owed to the company. What do you mean by creditors? We owe to other companies. So therefore, there are three set of ratios in activity or turnover or performance ratios. Let's start with the first one. Stock / inventory. Stock anna inventory anna confuse avadirana. Both are one and the same. Stock in turnover ratio anna inventory turnover ratio is one and the same. Inventory and the stock that the company have. These are the two synonyms that we use in accounting. Shall we start with the first theory? Did you follow? Why do we calculate this? Now. Yes, Dana?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Now write down the heading. Stock / inventory turnover ratio. The formula for this is stock or inventory turnover ratio is equal to stock or inventory turnover ratio is equal to cost of goods sold divided by average inventory. Cost of goods sold divided by average inventory. The formula is not there. Cost of goods sold divided by average inventory. Can you see, Nana? Cost of goods sold divided by average inventory. Where cost of goods sold is equal to sales minus gross profit. He will give you sales and he will give percentage of gross profit. Or if we don't give anything, sales would be assumed as cost of goods sold. Okay. Then the below average inventory is equal to opening stock plus closing stock divided by 2. You would be provided opening stock. You would be provided closing stock. You need to calculate average inventory. What is average inventory? Opening stock plus closing stock divided by 2. Is it clear, Nana?
inventory turnover ratio is equal to cost of goods sold divided by average inventory, where cost of goods sold is equal to sales. The sales, you know, what do you mean by sales of a firm? Minus gross profit. That is known as cost of goods sold. Then average inventory, opening stock plus closing stock divided by 2. Is it clear, Nana?
Yes, ma'am.
Now,
yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Now, take down a problem. Calculate inventory turnover ratio. Calculate inventory turnover ratio where sales are 5 lakhs, gross profit 20% of sales, inventory at the beginning of the year 16,000, closing 14,000. Okay, Nana. Now calculate cost of goods sold. Cost of goods sold is nothing but the item that you have in the trading account. Okay. Sales minus gross profit, this is the cost of goods sold. They are all items that we have taken: opening stock, purchases, carriage, inwards, wages. The total of all that is known as cost of goods sold. Okay. So if you remove sales minus cost of goods sold, you will get gross profit. So here, cost of goods sold is equal to sales minus gross profit, 4 lakhs. And what is average inventory? Opening plus closing divided by 2, you got 15. Now, what is inventory turnover ratio? 4 lakhs divided by 15,000. So inventory turnover ratio is 26.6 times. In a year, this company is able to convert its stock into cash by 26.6 times. Is it clear, Nana? This is the answer for inventory turnover ratio. And to find out, how many days for each time of this 26.6, we have another formula that is known as inventory holding period. Can you see here? Inventory holding period. Inventory holding period is equal to 365 days divided by inventory turnover ratio. Then what is the 365 is nothing but the number of days in a year divided by 26.6 is what we got the inventory turnover ratio. So per order, we have 13.6 days. Okay, so we have inventory turnover ratio 26.6 times in a year. So how many days is each time to identify that? We calculate inventory holding period, that is 365 divided by inventory turnover ratio. So each time of this 26.6 times, how many days it constitutes? 13.6 times. Sorry, 136. Okkasari chudandi nana. Ee ammayi em rasindi antu. 365 divided by 26.6. How much do you get the answer? Is it 13.6 or is it?
It's 13.7201.
Okay. 13.72,
ma'am. Yeah, 13.7 until you can take it as 14 days. Okay, per time it is 14 days. So this is inventory holding period. Is it clear, Nana? This is all about first ratio in turnover ratios or activity ratios. Any doubts in this? Shall we move on to debtor turnover ratio?
Okay.
Yeah, the higher is the better, Nana. Idi enta ekku unte anta capable is the company to convert its stock into cash. So the interpretation what you write is the higher the better. So the company is good in converting its stock into cash as it's 26.6 times. Okay. Now just do a problem quickly. Calculate inventory turnover ratio. Calculate inventory turnover ratio. From the given information. C Sales 4 lakhs. Sales 4 lakhs. Opening stock. Opening stock 20,000. Closing stock. Sorry, opening stock 40,000. Closing stock 60,000. Opening stock 40, closing 60. In brackets, you write. Sixty percent sales were on credit. So it's there already, the problem. So here we call, if credit information is given, we'll take only credit sales, Nana, because for this we need to convert into cash. So therefore, we consider only credit sales. So here we even have sales returns of 20,000. Take down sales returns 20,000. So first, what we need to do, calculate cost of goods sold. So cost of goods sold is how much? Sales minus sales returns 3,80,000, out of which we consider only 60% on credit. Why do we consider only credit? Because the capability of the company is how quickly it converts its credit sales into cash. Okay, so the more detailed ratio would be credit sales. If they don't give any credit information, we just take sales minus sales returns. But here they have given the credit information, out of which 60% were on credit. Cash, there is nothing to convert into cash, isn't it? So here we, to be more crystal clear, we calculate only credit sales. Are you getting my point, Nana? What is this ratio? Why do we calculate the ratio? To identify the capability of the company, how efficient is the company to convert its stock into credit, cash. So here, cash sales, and already they have received the cash. So what is there into converting the stock into cash, for which you need to identify the capability for credit sales. So we have to calculate exclusively how much are the credit sales, and then we calculate the inventory turnover ratio. Did you follow, Nana? This is an extra point in the case of inventory turnover ratio. Any doubts?
No, ma'am.
Yeah, so here, if he gives credit sales information, then only we take credit sales. If not, we assume the total sales were on credit, and then we take sales minus sales returns, if at all sales returns are given. If nothing is given, just sales are given, we assume the total sales were on credit, and then we take total sales and calculate cost of goods sold if he gives a gross profit. So here there is no gross profit. So what we do, we take the credit sales as cost of goods sold. And what is average stock? 60,000 plus 40,000 divided by 2, 50,000. And what is inventory turnover ratio? 4.56 times. And what is inventory holding period? 365 divided by 4.56. So each time is how much? 80.04 days. Did you get it, Nana, all of you? This is the first type of ratio, activity ratio, that is stock turnover or inventory turnover ratio. Shall we move on to the next ratio? Any doubts here?
No, ma'am.
All of you?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, now going to the next one. Debtors turnover ratio. So what is this ratio? This ratio reveals how efficient is the company to collect all its cash in one accounting period. Debts. What do you mean by debtors? Debtors are nothing but the debts what the other people owe to the company. So how efficient is the company to collect all its debts? The formula is credit sales divided by average debtors. So here also we take credit sales. Can you tell me why we take only credit sales now? By now you know, isn't it? Why we take only credit sales, not the full sales? Are you there?
Because only 10% of sales, the company can do it efficiently.
Because, is that the answer? Yes, anyone, Nana? Yeah, just.
Company received only that amount of sales.
Yeah, so who is this?
72.
Yeah, Nana, very good. Because you have to collect only these amount, isn't it? Credits, what do you mean by credit sales? You have issued goods, but they didn't pay you, isn't it? So how efficient are you to get back what they need to pay? That tells this ratio, that is known as debtors turnover ratio, converting debts into cash. So for which we consider only credit sales. Cash sales, we already received cash. There is nothing to show your capability. Now, credit sales is what you know. And average debtors, how do you take average debtors? Same as average inventory, that is opening stock plus closing stock divided by opening debtors plus closing debtors divided by 2. Every information would be given. You just need to calculate the debtors turnover ratio. Now write down, calculate debtors turnover ratio where sales 4 lakhs, out of which 60% were on credit. Opening debtors 25,000, closing debtors 15,000. So calculate first the credit sales. 60% of 4 lakhs, how much? 2,40,000. Quickly do the problem. Debtors turnover ratio is equal to 12 times. And we even do debt collection period. What is debt collection period? 365 divided by debtors turnover ratio. Is it clear, Nana? And each time, how much do you have? That is known as debt collection period, DCP. Debt collection period is equal to 365 divided by 12. Is it clear, all of you?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So this is all about debt equity ratio. Sorry, debtors turnover ratio. Okay, now going to the creditors turnover ratio, that is reverse of debtors turnover ratio. Here we have taken credit sales. Here we have to take credit purchases. Nana. Okay, in debtors turnover ratio, we have taken credit sales. In credit turnover ratio, we take credit purchases because we need to pay to our people whom we have taken the goods. So therefore, credit purchases divided by average creditors. So here, take a problem. Calculate creditors turnover ratio. Calculate creditors turnover ratio where purchases are 1,50,000. Purchases 1,50,000, out of which 60% were on credit. Opening creditors 32,000. Closing creditors 26,000. Now calculate creditors turnover ratio. Thank you. How much do you get, Nana? What is creditors turnover ratio are you doing?
Yes, ma'am.
Enta nana? Yeah, very good. 3.1 and calculate credit payment period. Credit payment period is equal to 365 divided by 365 divided by creditors turnover ratio. Credit payment period is equal to 118 days. Good now. So now just take down the last problem in this. Calculate debtors turnover ratio and creditors turnover ratio from the given information. Opening debtors 12,000, closing debtors 14,000, opening creditors 28,000, closing creditors 42,000, sales 3,60,000, 75% on credit, purchases 2,25,000, 60% on credit. Will you do it, Nana? Quickly tell me.
Ma'am, once can you repeat the sales and credit?
Sales 3,60,000, out of which 75% were credit. Purchases 2,25,000, 60% on credit. Okay. Anything else? Calculate both debt collection period and credit payment period also. How much did you get, ma'am?
Madam, is opening credit 28K, madam?
Nana, opening credit is 28K. K rayadu nana, meeru full rayali exam la kuda.
Okay, madam.
I observe most of the students will write K, write full, and I will always write the formula before you calculate, because these are not much good big calculations, isn't it? Formula rase neat ga calculation chesi, then neat ga interpretation rastene full marks vastayi. Send the answers.
Debt collection period is.
Okay. First, tell me debtors turnover ratio.
20.769.
Yeah, very good. 20.76 times. Then what is?
CTR is 3.86.
Yeah, 3.86. Yeah. And what is the debt collection period and credit holding period, credit payment period?
Debt collection period is 18 days. Debt collection period is around 18 days. And credit payment period is around 95 days.
Yeah.
18 days, yeah, 17.58 to 18 days. And this is? This one, Anak, 3.8.
94.8, so around.
Yeah, 95 days.
It's 94.8, so 95.
Yeah. And all of you got it? Shall we move on? 11-2 in there. Shall we continue or take some other time? We have third set of ratios, that is capital structure ratios, and the last one is profitability ratios. Capital structure ratios, we have three. Yes, Suna, shall we take next time or shall I continue? What do you say?
Continue.
What do you say, all of you? 11:30 work this caller.
Continue, ma'am.
Is it fine?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Now, yes, ma'am. Is it okay with all? Yeah. Now, take down the next set, capital structures ratio, under which the first one is debt equity, debt hyphen equity ratio. Debt hyphen equity ratio. Capital structures ratio, the first one is debt equity ratio. So this ratio helps us to identify capital structure and leverage and financial ratios, one and the same. So these ratios are calculated based on the capital. Till now we have done with current assets, current liabilities, we have done with debtors, we have done with creditors, we have done with sales and all. So this type of ratios will concentrate on the long-term debts and the long-term financial position of the firm. And the standard for this ratio is 1:1. And here the investors compare how much is the debt of the company and how much is the equity. And what do you mean by debt? Debt are nothing but the funds that have bought from outside. Okay, the funds that outsider funds is what we say. Debts refer to outsider funds and equity refer to insider funds. So what constitutes debts? We have debentures, bonds, long-term loans. These we will pick up from the balance sheet and calculate. These we pick up from the balance sheet and calculate debts. Okay. And coming to equity, what do you mean by equity? Share capital, that is both preference share capital and equity share capital, reserves and retained earnings. Okay, these all constitute equity, and the ratio for this is 1:1. We add all these items of debts and add all items of equity to compare what is the proportionate ratio of outsider funds with insider funds. For every 1 rupee of outsider fund, there should be 1 rupee of insider funds. Debt account, it's a danger, isn't it? Why do you think it's a danger? Why? Because if only fixed, manam debentures ki fixed amount of interest we have to pay, whatever may be the profits. Irrespective of your profits, you have to pay off your debentures, you have to pay off your interest on bonds, you have to pay off your long-term loans. Long-term loans, and what do you pay for the loans? Interest, isn't it? So if we equate, it's a danger. Why? Because the company should compulsorily have the commitment of paying off to all these. Share capital and a preference share capital we have fixed, but equity share capital, how much we have profits. So in a year of higher profits, we give more of dividends, and the year of lesser profits, we maintain a minimum returns for this equity share capital. And what do you mean by reserve? Reserves are nothing but to play safe, we maintain certain accounts known as a reserve. And the profits a part would be maintained as reserve. For it may be regarding reserve for depreciation or reserve for contingencies. And a contingency, and anything may happen anytime. So we maintain certain amount of cash that is known as reserve. And retained earnings, what do you mean by retained earnings? I think you know what do you mean by retained earnings. Why do the company maintain retained earnings? After meeting all its obligations, the balance of profits will be transferred to retained earnings account. So this is equity.
Is it clear, Nana? Now calculate debt equity ratio from the following information. Take down the problem. Debentures 4 lakhs. Long term loan 2 lakhs. Share capital 2,50,000. General reserve 2,50,000. General reserve 2,50,000. Retained earnings 1,00,000. Retained earnings 1,00,000. Now what is the debt? 4,00,000 plus 2,00,000, 6,80,000.
Both are 6,00,000, 1:1.
1:1. So it is satisfactory, isn't it? For every 1 rupee of debt, there is 1 rupee of equity. So this is how we calculate on a simple, take from the capital information, long-term liability is what we say. Current liabilities, we calculate current asset. Long-term liability, so fixed, e amount fixed, ante debentures, long-term loans. And in the case of equity, share capital, that is both equity, preference, reserves, retained earnings, and profit and loss account, if at all we have anything. It is also known as retained earnings. Okay. So this is what debt equity ratio, the first ratio. Any doubts? Shall we move on to the next ratio?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, now take down the next ratio. So this is one of the problem. Anyhow, I'll forward this PDF, Nana. In the notes of a student, I'll forward. You can practice these problems. Okay. The next one is interest coverage ratio. Write down the next one. Interest coverage ratio. The formula is, interest coverage ratio formula is net profit before interest and tax. Net profit before interest and tax divided by fixed interest charges. Every information will be given. You just need to apply the formula and calculate. Net profit before interest and tax. Now, take down a problem. The earnings of a company before interest and tax, 5,60,000. The earnings of a company before interest and tax is 5,60,000. Its fixed interest charges include ₹10 on 7,000 debentures of 100 each. So first, how do you calculate the interest? How many debentures are there? 7,000 debentures of 100 each. So the value of debentures are 7,00,000. On this 10%, 70,000. So this is known as fixed interest charges. So the debentures will be issued like this, Nana. 10% debentures of 7,000 of 100 each. So this is how the debentures will be issued. So what do you mean by this 10%? 10% is nothing but rate of interest. 7,000 is number of debentures. And what is the value of each debenture? 100. So fixed interest charges, how do you calculate? 7,000 into 100, 7,00,000. 7,00,000, 10%, the interest charges are 70,000. Now what is the formula? And earnings before interest and tax divided by fixed interest charges. So 5,60,000 divided by 70, 8 times. So here we take in times. So the company is capable to pay off its interest charges by 8 times. So if you want to buy a debenture of a firm, this is what the ratio they check. What is the interest coverage ratio? So the company is based on its earnings. It is capable of paying 8 times of its interest. So it's a good sign to invest your debentures in this company. Did you follow, Nana? Did you follow, all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Yeah, you have to be careful what are the fixed interest charges, and you have to be careful whether the earnings are before interest and tax. Sometimes what he'll do, he will give separately earnings in the interest in the tax in the after tax, and you have to add tax and you have to add interest. Why? Because you calculate before interest, before tax. Is that clear? No? Be careful whether the earnings are before tax and interest or after tax and interest. Here in this problem, he has directly given it is before interest and before tax. After iste em chestamana, we will add back the interest and tax to get earnings before interest and tax. And careful while calculating the fixed interest charges, number of debentures, value of debentures, and percentage of interest should be carefully seen and calculate the amount of interest to be paid. Is it clear, Nana, all of you? So this ratio helps the investors to identify whether it is safe for the company, it is safe for the investors to invest in the debentures and loans or not. Is this clear? Shall we move on to the last ratio?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
The last ratio. The last ratio is regarding, I don't think here it is. Interest coverage ratio. Proprietary funds to, write down, ratio of proprietary funds to total assets. It is not given here. Ratio of proprietary funds to total assets. Ratio of proprietary funds to total assets. The formula is proprietary funds divided by total assets into 100. Proprietary funds divided by total assets into 100. So this, the standard for this is 50%. Okay, the standard for this is 50%. What is this ratio? This ratio is just in general calculated to identify how much are the proprietary funds involved in purchasing the total assets of the firm, and how much it can be. The standard is 50%. Is it clear, Nana? The standard is 50%. So you can have the total assets from proprietary funds to how much? 50%. What do you mean by proprietary funds? Proprietary funds are nothing but the insider funds. Is it clear? Proprietary funds are nothing but insider funds. Insider funds which we have taken in debt equity ratio. Okay. So here, this is how we calculate. And we have to take the proprietary funds total divided by the total assets given into 100. The standard is 50%. If at all he asks just current assets, proprietary funds to fixed assets, you segregate what are fixed assets. Proprietary funds to current assets, you segregate current assets and take down the ratio. Okay. This is what we have in capital structure ratios. Is it clear, Nana? So this is what we have,
yes,
in capital structure ratios. The last profitability ratios is what we have. We'll take this in the next class. Because what is the problem is it has been 1 o'clock to finish off doing the question paper. As we got the information, my neck is paining a lot by sitting so many hours in front of system. I'm not able to sit even now. Because from 7 o'clock till 12, I was just making the paper. Done with 3 sets, only profitability ratio migilipoyindi. I'll send you the notes, and if these are the ratios that we have in profitability. GP ratio, net profit ratio, operating ratio, return on investment, earnings per share, and dividend yield ratio. This takes a half an hour. When possible, we'll take even this. Okay. We have 6 ratios in this. Simple ratios, even this. Is it clear, Anna? Shall I wind off now? This is what you have, isn't it? Unit 4 important questions. Can you see, Nana? Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So here, short questions. Define the concept of accounting. You have definition, isn't it? Given by International Accounting Standards of America. You have to write that stand accounting, this one, or you can write any definition, whichever you like. Okay. Then ledger, what do you mean by ledger? Ledger is nothing but posting in the ledger from the transactions. Define the ledger. Then subsidiary books. Subsidiary books are nothing but what are different accounts that we maintain in the ledger are known as subsidiary books. Cash account is one subsidiary book. Purchase account is one subsidiary book. Sales account is a subsidiary book. Subsidiary books are nothing but different accounts that we maintain in ledger are known as subsidiary books. And accounting concepts, how many accounting concepts are there?
Four.
Four.
Three accounts.
Accounting concept. Three. What is this number you are telling? Whatever you like. Accounting principles are classified into two, accounting concepts and accounting conventions. Accounting concepts constitutes eight. Accounting conventions constitute four. Did you forget? Nana, much better.
No, ma'am.
Accounting concepts, 8 plus 4, 12. Okay? 8 MO concepts, 4 MO conventions. Now, what do you mean by double entry bookkeeping? It's nothing but two-way effect. For each and every debit, there would be a corresponding credit. Any transaction occurs twice, effect in the books of accounts. If one is debited, the other should be credited. Give any example, okay? Now, balance sheet. What do you mean by balance sheet? Balance sheet is nothing but the financial position which constitutes assets and liabilities. Current assets, current liabilities. Current assets and fixed assets, the current liabilities and capital is what we have in the case of balance sheet. Now, journalize the following transactions. What are the rules? We have three rules, isn't it? To maintain books of accounts. Now, what is an adjustment? What do you mean by an adjustment, Nana? Are you there, all of you?
After the transaction is given, if any changes or returns happens.
And how does it affect? It affects twice.
Twice, yes,
once in trading account and
another balance.
Once in profit and loss account and balance. Now discuss the types and rules of accounting. Rules of accounting are three. Personal account, nominal account and real account. Distinguish between single entry and double entry. What do you mean by single entry? Only once we record the payment of cash, that's it. Purchase of, so only once it affects is known as single entry bookkeeping, and double entry bookkeeping is good as it's systematic and it gives a true and a fair view of business transactions. Okay. Now, longs, what are accounting concepts and conventions? What do you mean by double entry bookkeeping? Rules to pass a journal entries. So these are the theory questions. Apart from this, pass the journal entries and post in the ledger final accounts. Prepare the final accounts from the given balance sheet or prepare the trial balances. Trial balance ante unna balance nunchi edi debit ostundi edi credit ostundi, you have to identify and put the debit and credit, and the total of debit should be equal to total of credit in the trial balance. You have this in the RA Sri Nana. Just refer what constitutes debit balances and what constitute credit balances. Is it clear? This is all about unit 4. Any doubts in this? And adjustments and high end problems are not given for you. Don't worry, simple problem. Attempt problem, if at all you can do it. If not, go for the theory. Okay. So this is unit 4 and unit 3. These are the MCQs kuda chusukondi Anna, unit 3, unit 4, okay? Unit 3 important questions can anyone have? Just send me. You ఇంపార్టెంట్ క్వశ్చన్స్ ఆఫ్ యూనిట్ 3 మీ దగ్గర ఎవరి దగ్గర అయినా ఉందా నాన్న?
నో మ్యామ్.
Can you open it if not? And tell me the question wise.
Okay.
రాలేనా? ఓకే, ఇఫ్ నాట్ నన్ను ఓపెన్ చేయి నువ్వు.
మ్యామ్ ఒకసారి రిఫ్రెష్ చేసి చూడండి. మ్యామ్
చేస్తాను. యా వచ్చింది వచ్చింది శ్రీచర. Yeah, so this is unit 3, define production function. Production function is a proportion of input to output is known as production function, and production function y is equal to function of L1, L2, COT. So this is what the definition of production function. A return to factors or return to scales, we have how many? 3, isn't it? Increasing return to scale, decreasing returns to scale, constant return to scale. Now, break-even point, you know what do you mean by break-even point? So if it is short, just define it. If it is long, explain along with the diagram, Nana, all of you. Did I forward that to you, PPT? Nana, forward chesan nenu kade?
No, ma'am. At 3 units notes, okati pampare.
Pump, avuna, ledhu nenu pampistha leku. Inka adjustments kuda pampistha. Then next, angle of incidence is fixed cost. What do you mean by break-even point? Fixed cost plus and variable cost. You know what do you mean by fixed cost and what do you mean by variable cost? And what do you mean by angle of incidence and is nothing but arc and point of this one is known as angle of incidence. So you have to write regarding elasticity law, we get angle of incidence. So what do you, calculation of elasticity at one point is known as point elasticity, and arc elasticity is at two points. So this is known as angle of incidence. So this is the concept that we have in unit 2, but why did we have here? Okay, leave about this. Now going to the next one, isoquant. What do you mean by isoquant? Unit 3. Two variable input
equal
factor.
Quantity.
Yeah, the isoquant throughout and the quantities throughout an isoquant is equal quantities. And how is an isoquant? Downward sloping from left to right. Now, kink demand curve, in which market structure will this come? Kink demand
oligopoly, ma'am.
Very good. Oligopoly. And why is there kink? Because there is a lot of interdependence, and at the kink, at the point of kink, above it is elastic, below it is inelastic. Why? Because if one increases, the other does not increase. If one decreases, the others also increase. So therefore, we have kink demand curve at point K. What is historical cost and incremental cost? Historical cost refer to the cost at the time of acquisition. Incremental cost refer to cost in increase in cost due to increase in production is known as incremental cost. Now, demand-based pricing, we have two, perceived value pricing and price discrimination. Do you remember, Nana, pricing methods? You have the notes of pricing, methods of pricing? Unnai mee digra.
Ma'am, BSAQ kabatti just demand-based pricing ante ento raste chaala, ma'am.
Chalu, but ee rendu kuda unnai ante aipothundi.
Okay.
Perceived value pricing and price discrimination. Now, least cost combination of inputs is nothing but minimum cost of production, isn't it? So, this you just write where you get the minimum point where it is tangential to the long run cost curve, isn't it? That is known as least cost combination. Long run cost and output relationship law, we get least cost combination. where the third short run cost curve is tangential to the long run at a minimum point, that is known as least cost combination. Now, essay questions explain law of variable proportion. We have three stages. What is this? If we keep other variables, other factors fixed, one variable, what happens to the production? Increasing, constant, and decreasing. Okay, then returns to scale and long run production function. Returns to scale, three, increasing, constant, decreasing. Long run production function, we have a big average long run cost curve of, and we show superimposing four short run average cost curves on long run average cost curve. Do you remember, Nana, all of you? Much better, Ivani, third unit?
No, madam.
Yeah. Now, production function with two variable and what do you write? Isoc cost, isoc went, and least cost combination. Okay. Then explain what do you mean by two variable production function and write the features of isoc went and what do you mean by isoc cost and what are the six combinations. Okay. Define cost, define different types of cost. So, different types. Different types of cost, and actually we have 15, isn't it? 13 to 15 we have. We have clearly mentioned, write any five or like that. Okay, you can write of your choice any five. If at all you got the question. Is that clear, Nana? Now explain cost and output relationship and short run and long run. This is what you have already done. Now what happens in short run, except average fixed cost, anni kuda perugutai with the increase in production. Isn't it? We'll show dotted lines of average fixed cost and remaining all we show in the dark line. Why? Because all the other costs increase with increase in production. Now, features of monopoly, causes and features of monopoly. What do you mean by monopoly? One seller, many buyers. Causes we have separately given in the notes. Patent rights, R&D, government policies. Gurta Chanana. Features also, yes, I have given you. I have forwarded the notes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Now, difference between perfect, and you have to write comparison. Perfect competition and monopoly. Point of distinction, Rasi. Perfect competition, monopoly. First, number of buyers, number of sellers, price taker, price receiver, like that. You write the points of distinction and then differentiate between perfect competition and monopoly. And price and output determination, perfect competition and monopolistic competition. So, in the tough way, the paper is very simple. So, we didn't give you so tough. Why? Because you were not prepared for offline exam. Okay. So, don't worry. Edrasana, write neatly, present in a perfect manner with wherever possible diagrams, highlight the side headings. And one answer is over, draw a line and start with the next answer. So that I need not search where does the second answer start with. Okay. So price and output determination, anyhow, we have done this. If at all you get, you can write, but such tough questions are not there in your exam. Okay. Define pricing and what are the methods of pricing? We have four methods of pricing broadly classified into competition-based, cost-based, demand-based, and strategy-based. Okay? Is it clear, Nana?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, explain product lifecycle-based pricing. We have four stages, isn't it? Introduction, growth, stagnation, or maturity, then decline. So each stage low, what are the strategies that we use? Like introduction stage low, we use, what are the two methods? Either penetration or skimming, isn't it? Define break-even analysis and its assumptions. Okay, what are its assumptions? Break-even analysis. We don't have any assumptions, like only just define and explain the concept of break-even analysis. Okay. So this is what the concept of production, market structures and pricing. Is it clear, Nana? All of you, indulo nunchi vastayi questions. So This is what unit 4 and unit 5, which I have discussed. Shall we wind up?